Mr. Singhvi, we read this morning in the newspaper that you had drafted three plans for what the Congress might do if the NDA was to fall short of those numbers, but I guess you don't need any of those plans now. What is your first reaction, Dr. Singhvi, to the results today, or to the leads at least?
You're right. All plans depend on numbers. And absolutely, those plans will be activated if and only if the numbers come. But let me start with one small quick caveat that at 10:30 is not a good time to celebrate, to be depressed or to introspect. As you know, for national elections, the correct time is post 12. There are lots and lots of surprises which have happened earlier. The degree and the detail also can vary. However, having said that, if the trends as they show today persist, then I think it's a runaway victory for Mr. Modi, not so much for the BJP, and he deserves full credit for it if it happens in this figure as it's showing now. If you then ask me, again, we are doing an assumptions on the same figures, what happened, what led to this? I think, it's a very simple answer. I think we had actually a very positive four-point program. Somewhere that message got lost. The four-point program was jobs, agricultural distress, economy, and the Rafael corruption issue. The last one was partly communicated, the other appears not to have been, because there are serious figures and facts there which are alarming. Equally, I think these three and four got overwhelmed by the successful marketing of two or three very negative things by Mr. Modi. This is clearly, first of all, an election where in large parts of India, and West Bengal is certainly one example out of many, where he has polarized. He has worked on polarization, divisiveness, fear, provocation, etc. And it has worked. And ultimately, success has many fathers, failure is an orphan. But it's still not a good thing, the reason for this success. Second, I think he successfully harnessed our armed forces, something consciously not done by any of our predecessor prime ministers for political gain. But he did it. He did it cleverly, but most importantly, he has managed to do it successfully. He brazenly and unashamedly harnessed our armed forces into the political campaign with posters, with photos, with innuendos, with references, with all kinds of imagery. And that again appears to have worked. I don't think he has much to tom-tom about his concrete successes, save and except one area, roads and highways, maybe partially the Ujjwala scheme, but that is pretty expensive at the end of the day. On all those fronts, there have been miserable failures as well. But then, chemistry and overall package matters. And somewhere, in case these trends hold, it means that these issues have overwhelmed the earlier ones I said.
Abhishek, what does this mean for Rahul Gandhi's leadership? Will there be questions asked?
Well, I think, Rahul Gandhi has led from the front. He has never hesitated to come in at unpopular moments. He came with the nadir, in fact. He's never hesitated to take up unpopular causes. And he has always believed in taking a bullet in the chest. I think people appreciate that. Above all, people appreciate his sincerity. He fought a very good election. He fought a clean battle. He did not stoop to any real, negativity. He met arguments and he advanced them. Now, we have to bow down. I mean, he has to bow down as much as I have to bow down to the electorate's mandate. And I agree that this is not mere introspection. If these figures hold, we need reinvention. That reinvention will happen, but it will take some time. And one of the reinventions, according to me, should be to start a process where you start thinking of making solid individual state-level persons who are allowed to grow in 3 years to 4 years, to make each state your own. Now will be the time where if you decide to do Akla Chalo in a particular area, you start now, not 3 years later, near the elections. Those are all matters of manthan, of introspection, but more importantly of reinvention, and I can assure you it will happen.
You want a question for Abhishek?
Abhishek Singhvi, we've been hearing about this reinvention, developing state leaders for several years now. I mean, the Congress has done nothing on this front. Nothing. Even this time, when you managed to win three states, you chose older people, the old experienced war horses, to be your chief ministers instead of, you know, putting in young faces, both in Madhya Pradesh and Rajasthan. So where, you know, where is this reinvention? Where is this, you know, sort of developing state level leaders? You have not shown any signs of doing it so far.
I agree that we have not shown the requisite degree. But you are wrong if you think that we have not done it. It is not a question of age. It's a question of a mix of attraction, popularity, experience and age. We have done it in Gujarat. You have the name, Paresh Dharani. We have done it in both Madhya Pradesh and Rajasthan. The deputy chief minister is a very capable, and you know, you have to go together. In Madhya Pradesh, we have done it. It doesn't mean that I have to become a chief minister to have done it. It's a very important triumvirate of leaders there, especially two of them, the Guna candidate and the chief minister. So I think it's a good mix. I agree with you that we need to do it more in some other states. But the process is happening. And, you know, the nowhere are these permanent things. They change. So we've got in a line, sort of people. I think what we need to do is to expand it to other states. Akla Chalo and this may have to be combined in some states where we have lost our footprint altogether. And to be honest, Uttar Pradesh is a prime example.
You know, Abhishek, just a last question before we let you go. You mentioned that there were plans. Those plans will only be activated based on the results. What were those plans?
You want to rub it in, do you?
I don't want to rub it in. I'm just curious as a journalist.
They are largely in public domain. They've been reported in the press. So I don't think I'm doing any indiscretion by sharing a model, because the model is very realistic in terms of numbers. We are not being presumptuous. We are not disrespecting the people's mandate. We would have proceeded on plans only if the numbers were correct. Broadly, the plan is what I had conceptualized as post-poll pre-result. That was the phrase I had conceptualized. Post-poll pre-result is that there is out there, of course, a declared NDA, a declared UPA. But any time till today morning, there is also a huge gathering out there which is anti-NDA, anti-BJP, but not part of UPA. If that gathering was to either join the UPA or otherwise proceed to declare in writing their intention not to support any NDA formation, but to support a non-NDA formation, that would be step one, an intention to be communicated to the President of India. Step two, again subject to numbers, would be to then lay claim to the government later in the day after the numbers are fully out. And step three would be to nominate your leader. I am giving you a process which is a constitutional process, which is a legal process, which is a realistic process, and which is in conformity with conventions and political reality if the numbers come through. Beyond that, to get the signatures is neither my job nor does it happen unless the numbers come through.
Right. Well, Abhishek, I actually didn't think that you would outline what the plans were. But thanks very much indeed for joining us. Thanks very much.